In the case of powders, liquid orals, ointments, etc., one batch number shall be assigned to all the containers that are filled from a homogeneous bulk. In case of tablets, capsules, lozenges that are unit dosage forms, one batch number shall be assigned to the products that are manufactured from one homogeneous mixture that is ready for compression or filling. So in case of liquid orals or ointments which are bulk formulations, when the bulk is ready in the manufacturing tank or the storage tank, all the contents of that bulk, when they are filled into bottles or tubes or jars, will have the same batch number. Similarly, once a bulk of granules is ready for compression or bulk powder is ready for filling into capsules, all the tablets or capsules manufactured from that bulk will have a common batch number. In case of parenteral preparations, it is sterilization which will determine the batch number. So the parenteral preparations sterilized by steam under pressure, then all those containers which have been, all that bulk which has been sterilized at one time in one autoclave, when it is further subdivided into smaller ampoules or vials, will have one batch number. So the entire load sterilized in one sterilization cycle in one autoclave gets a single batch number. It may be filled into 1000 vials, it may be filled into 5 lakh ampoules. But all those 5 lakh ampoules will have the same batch number because the most critical activity of sterilization of the entire bulk has been done together. Therefore, the entire batch of vials, ampoules, ointment jars, etc. gets this same batch number. In case of containers of parenteral preparations filled from one homogeneous bulk and sterilized in more than one sterilizer load, batch number assigned to the containers in the different sterilizer loads shall be the same. Sometimes the solution is manufactured at once, a large volume is manufactured, it is then filled into smaller containers and subsequently sterilized in different lots in the sterilizer, yet they will have the same batch number. Every drug manufactured in India shall bear on its label the number of the license under which the drug is manufactured, the figure representing the manufacturing license number, which is preceded by the words either manufacturing license number in full form or MFGLICNO or simply ML. Drugs specified in Schedule P and their preparations, including the combinations with other drugs, shall bear on their labels the date of manufacture and the date of expiry of potency. Drugs specified in Schedule C1 and their preparations, including the combination with other drugs, shall bear on the label the date of manufacture, the date of expiry of potency as fixed by the manufacturer, where such drugs are imported, also the number of license under which the drug is imported, and the words import license are first written and then the license number is written. You can go through another label here where all this information is written. So you have first the manufacturing license number, the batch number where the abbreviations B.NO. come first, followed by the batch number, which remember is the unique identity of the batch. Then you have the manufacturing date. If you see the manufacturing date and the expiry date, you will realize that it is only the month and the year which is mentioned. None of the marketed formulations carry the date They only carry the month, so 04. That means it was manufactured in April 2009, and the product will expire in March 2011. So the shelf life is 24 months. MRP means maximum retail price, which in this case is 125 rupees. And MRP is inclusive of all taxes, which means that the retailer cannot charge anything above the 125 rupees that has been printed on the label. Thus, we have started with the very top, that is the title of the product. We looked at the way in which we write the contents within the container. Finally, we come to that variable matter, which is overprinted on the label and includes the batch number, the manufacturer, the expiry, and the MRP. License may be printed on the label, or license also may be overprinted because the manufacturing is many a times carried out at multiple locations, and we have learned that one license for each location. So if there are multiple locations manufacturing the electoral sachets, then each will have its own license number. Therefore, license may be printed or it may be overprinted. All of you must have heard about physician's sample. That is a small part of the formulation that is given to the medical doctor or physician for him to use it and to observe it. Every drug, so the DNC rules and regulations say that every drug intended for distribution to the medical profession as a free sample shall, while complying with the labeling provisions under clauses 1 to 8, which we saw previously, further bear on the label of the container the words physician's sample not to be sold, which has to be overprinted. Okay. Another important point is, if any preparation contains not less than 3% by volume of alcohol, the quantity of alcohol shall be stated in terms of the average percentage by volume of absolute alcohol in the finished products. So these are two important points that we just saw here, that drugs that are intended to be given to the physician for use as physician's sample should contain all the matter that is mandatory on the label of any regular formulation. In addition, the words physician's sample not to be sold needs to be overprinted on that label. Secondly, as long as the formulation contains less than 3% volume by volume of alcohol, it need not be declared on the label. However, if the content of alcohol exceeds this amount, then the same should be stated on the label in terms of average percent by volume of absolute alcohol. Okay, yet one more important point. We have seen in the previous slide where I showed you example labels that the manufacturing date was given as 04/06, which is the month and the year. As I told you very specifically, the date should not be mentioned. The reason is this. For the purpose of this rule, the date of expiry shall be in terms of month and year, and it means that the drug is recommended till the last day of the month. Okay, the date of expiry is preceded by the words expiry date or EXP date, whatever it is. The main important point to note here is that if you buy a formulation from the market and its shelf life, or rather its date of expiry, is given as June 2021, you can still use it safely till 30th June, after which it is not recommended for usage. Thus, once again, the date of expiry is in terms of month and year. I've shown this example to you, and it shall mean that the drug is recommended till the last day of the month of on which it is supposed to expire. In addition to the other particulars which are required to be printed or written under these rules, the label of the innermost container of the following categories of drugs and every other covering in which the container is packed shall bear a conspicuous red vertical line on the left side running throughout the body of the label, and this band should not be less than 1 mm in width, and it should be printed on the label for these categories of drugs. That includes narcotics, analgesics, hypnotics, sedatives, tranquilizers, corticosteroids, hormones, hypoglycemics, antimicrobials, anti-epileptics, antidepressants, anticoagulants, anti-cancer drugs, and all drugs that fall under schedule G, H, and X, whether or not covered in this list. So what this tells us is that there are certain categories of drugs for which precautions are needed, and therefore it is recommended and mandatory to have a red line, a red thin band running through the left side of the label, and it does not disturb the other conditions. Some of the drug categories for which this is mandatory includes analgesics, hypnotics, sedatives, tranquilizers, corticosteroids, hormones, hypoglycemics, antimicrobials, anti-epileptics, antidepressants, anticoagulants, anti-cancer drugs, drugs falling under schedule G, H, and X. Observe the label of an ibuprofen tablet. As you can see, all the conditions we have discussed so far have been complied with, along with an additional requirement that is specified in the DNC Act and Rules, that is the presence of a red band at the left hand side for categories of drugs including NSAIDs, which brufen is. Okay, so remember, it is very important to have this red line running along the left hand side of the label without disturbing the other matter for certain categories of drugs which are specified as per the DNC Act and Rules. The container of a medicine for internal use shall, if it contains a substance specified in Schedule G, then be labeled with the words, "Caution, it is dangerous to take this preparation except under medical supervision." So these are special instructions that are to be put on the label if the drug belongs to Schedule G, and these words should be conspicuous, that means visible, and surrounded by a line or a box within which there shall be no other words. I will explain this to you with the help of an example in the next slide. Similarly, if the container contains a substance or drug specified in Schedule H, then it should be labeled with the symbol RX and conspicuously displayed on the left top corner of the label, that is RX, and also labeled with the words Schedule H drug warning, to be sold by retail on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. Thus, there are special instructions if the drug belongs to Schedule G or the drug belongs to Schedule H. In case of a Schedule G drug, the instructions that are given include, caution, it is dangerous to take this preparation except under medical supervision. In case of Schedule H drug, the symbol RX should be displayed on the left top corner, as well as the warning, Schedule H drug warning, to be sold by retail on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. As I move to the next slide, I will show you one label. Okay, coming to this label, you can see the top left hand corner is RX, so it's a Schedule H drug, and the Schedule H drug warning is displayed. to be sold on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. And you can see that these wordings are inside a box in which no other wordings are displayed. Okay, so this is how the pharma company which is marketing the drug makes sure that all the provisions that are laid down in the DNC Act and rules are complied with. So right from the top of the label to the bottom of the label, read each and everything that is printed. You will come to know that all the specifications, all the regulations are being complied with. So take a look at this label. Let us pause here and take a look at this label. I will not explain anything to you right here because I have been explaining each and every point to you as we go along. I will just keep circling it. So start thinking what has been told to you earlier about this point. Isn't it? All this has been explained to you. And I hope you can understand each and every aspect of this label and know that it is all mandatory. Special instructions, fixed information which is printed, and variable information that is overprinted. If the container contains a substance specified in Schedule H and comes under the purview of the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act 1985, then it should be labeled with the symbol NRX, not just RX but NRX, which shall be in red and conspicuously displayed on the left top corner of the label. And also the following words should be displayed: Schedule H drug warning, to be sold by retail on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. If the container contains a substance specified in Schedule X, it should be labeled with the symbol XRX and in red on the left top corner of the label, and also be labeled with the following words: Schedule X drug warning, to be sold by retail on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only. The container of a liniment, ointment, cream or any other medicine for external topical application shall be labeled with the words "for external use only." So if you refer the label of any external preparation, whether it is an ointment, cream or jelly, you will see these instructions each and every time. That is for external use only or not for consumption or some such similar warning, where it is very clear that this preparation is meant only for application to external surfaces of the body. Right, so here we are with an ointment label where you can see the instruction for external use only. So as you recollect, all these points have been discussed by me. The new point which I'm adding here is the for external use only, which is mandatory in case of all preparations that are meant for application on the external surfaces of the body. When can words like IP, BP and USP be used? Let us see what the DNC rules and regulations say. The letters IP and the recognized abbreviations of other pharmacopoeias and official compendia of drug standards which are prescribed under the rules can be used on the label of the drug only for the purpose of indicating that the drug is in accordance with the standards set out in the Indian pharmacopoeia or in any such pharmacopoeia or official compendium of drug standards that are recognized under the rules. We all know about the Indian pharmacopoeia and its status. Any drug that is official in the Indian pharmacopoeia or any formulation that is official in the Indian pharmacopoeia can use the words IP. Similarly, any drug official in the USP can use the words USP. Any formulation official in USP can use the words USP. So thus, any pharmacopoeia or other official books of other countries that are recognized under the DNC Act and rules, then the appropriate abbreviations can be used for those drug substances or drug products.